This week, the MasterChef heats have pitted five celebrities against each other.
It's like a disco.
I'm the calming influence in this room. Come on, come on, come on. You're taking it too easy, man.
It's so hot. I feel like my contacts are melting.
This is looking really correct.
Lovely.
Last time, actor Chizzy Akadolu went home. Now the remaining four are back to fight for their place in the semi-finals.
This isn't easy. And if you think it's a walk in the park, then think again.
I think I'm beginning to feel a bit more confident now. But if anything goes off plan, suddenly I'm completely panicking.
I will be able to work through anything that's given to me. I've had a lot of life experience. I just think, come on, Stephanie, you can deal with this. This is just food.
They've gone to the trouble of embroidering your name on an apron. You've really got to show up.
We pushed them in the first couple of rounds and made it here, but now we're going to really turn up the heat. Four decent cooks at the end of this will only have two left. Welcome back. You've done very well, you four. But this is where it starts to get a little bit tougher. We call this challenge the Pairs Challenge. And it's got nothing to do with fruit. It's because you are going to be working in pairs. Monty and Zoe, you'll be working together. Stephanie and Gemma, you're a team. Each team is tasked with cooking a dish. And we want two portions of that dish. Those two portions must be identical in appearance and in taste. The thing is, you will not be working next to each other. You will be working on the opposite side of the wall behind you.
You're basically, as a team, going to be working in two separate kitchens, but you can talk to each other over the wall. We're going to give you 5 minutes to prepare yourselves. On the benches behind you are all the ingredients and basic instructions. I suggest you make the most of those 5 minutes. Off you go.
Each team has been given a different dish.
We can do this.
With separate trays of ingredients for every element.
So, what have we got?
Monty and Zoe are each in charge of making John's chicken cordon bleu with rosemary potatoes and creamed corn.
Cordon bleu.
Cordon bleu.
Sounds very French to me.
It's very retro. I mean, this is a 1970s dish. There was veal cordon bleu, chicken Kiev, something stuffed inside a piece of meat and crumbed. First of all, they need to get the potatoes on because the potatoes take the longest. They've got to make sure that all their potatoes are the same size so they cook evenly.
Potatoes, they're going to take a while. We've only got 50 minutes.
The key to perfectly crisp potatoes is to cook them from cold in cold oil.
By heating up the oil slowly, the water disappears and the potatoes don't cook too quickly, don't go too brown, and you get crispy chips.
How long is that going to take?
15 to 20 minutes.
While the potatoes crisp, the next challenge is the chicken cordon bleu.
Chicken breast is still on the chicken. That's got to come off.
Which one's the breast?
This is the breast area right here.
They'll need to butterfly the chicken so they can stuff it. So your fat end is the hinge.
Ah, OK. So you cut into that.
That's right. And then just very gently bash it out. They've got to make sure it's all the same thickness, so it all cooks the same. And it should look like a butterfly.
The butterfly chicken is filled with ham and cheese and sealed.
Cut it in half and then put cheese and ham in there.
You don't want to cut it in half completely, I don't think. I think you're going to sort of have to cut the breast off and make a pocket.
Oh, right, a little pocket.
Do you know what I mean?
Stuff it, yeah.
And then stuff it. I think so, Monty. I haven't a clue. I've never stuffed a breast.
It's got to be totally enclosed so the cheese doesn't leach out.
Tricky.
To achieve the perfect crumb coating, the chicken is covered in flour, then egg, and finally the breadcrumbs.
That is the breadcrumbs. Flour, egg and that all together.
No, that's your breadcrumbs. It's on the bread. They haven't made this easy for us.
Really make sure there's lots of crumb on it so when it fries, it goes crispy.
How long is that going to take to cook?
8 to 10 minutes at the most.
If that pan's too hot, it will burn on them.
How do you shallow fry chicken?
Enough oil in the pan just to cook it, not enough so you're going to drown it.
Then you just leave the chicken in there and let it fry.
Let it fry.
This is a game of timing and a little bit of patience. Once these things are in, leave them. If they start prodding, they're going to take all the breadcrumb off of there and maybe even split the chicken open.
That's it. Leave it well alone.
The final element is the creamed corn.
Creaming of corn. I have no idea, Monty.
Corn taken off the husk, boiled up a little bit of stock and some butter, a little bit of seasoning, and then pureed.
Lovely and sweet.
Creamed corn needs to have texture. You should be able to see the kernels, but it shouldn't be crunchy. That's the colour we want. Nice and golden, crispy. And look, cold oil, crispy potatoes.
That's really clever. I'm very impressed with that.
The potatoes are mixed with a blend of ground rosemary and salt.
Good flavours going on here. Very nice.
A little bit of watercress to give it a bit of colour. And we have it.
I think they're going to have major problems with this. I think we're going to get hacked about chicken pieces. I think we're going to get stuffing coming out. I think we're going to get breadcrumbs burning. I fear for this chicken, John.
We're going to scream at each other through that partition.
Yeah.
And throw notes. We'll maybe write notes on the back of a potato and throw it over the top.
OK.
Yeah. It'd be like The Great Escape.
How many minutes should we cook it for?
Gemma and Stephanie will each have to replicate John's beef fillet in bacon with béarnaise sauce, served with straw potatoes and buttered rainbow chard.
First job has to be the butchery.
But that looks like a pretty big steak. Let's just do one each then, because I think two will be too much on the plate.
But maybe, like, about there.
The fillet steak is wrapped in bacon to add flavour and prevent it from drying out.
Let's just make it 2 bacon strips thick.
Or 3.
3 is really big.
Always oil the steak first, not the pan. Otherwise, all the oil on the outside of the pan will burn and it will taint the flavour of your steak.
I think that should go in an oven at a high heat. Yeah. Oh, hang on. No, it says here fry steaks.
So that's going to cook for about 5 minutes on each side, 10 minutes at the most.
What I want is a browned outside and a pink middle. Nothing worse than an under or overcooked steak.
No.
So let's leave the steak for the last 10 minutes. Let's prepare the rest.
Whilst they're cooking the steak, they need to get on with that béarnaise. To explain a béarnaise simply, it's a hot mayonnaise.
Have you ever made a béarnaise sauce?
No.
Gosh, me neither.
The base of the béarnaise is made by adding a reduction of vinegar, tarragon, peppercorns and shallots to egg yolks, and finally some butter.
Too hot and the egg in there could scramble.
Yes.
Too cool and that liquid butter will solidify.
Yes. And it gets to the stage called ribbon stage.
That ribbon stage is where the whisk is leaving firm trails.
That's right.
Extra punch comes from fresh tarragon and chervil.
OK, steak. Ooh. Butter across the top.
Oh, my word. And that's got to now rest for quite a while.
Now it's got to rest for a good 10 minutes.
While the steak rests, the celebrities will have to fry off the Swiss chard.
Cook the stem and the leaves of the chard separately.
Oh.
Gee, I wasn't a greengrocer for nothing.
And also make their straw potatoes by deep frying thinly sliced chards.
What's mandolin?
This is a mandolin.
I don't know how to use this.
That's just steam coming out of your potatoes. Potatoes got water in them, that's just the steam going. Process is simply taking away the water from the potatoes to make them crisp. It's dehydrating.
It's becoming a crispy nest. Go on.
There you go, that's what we want. Steak, Swiss chard, straw potatoes, béarnaise sauce.
Do you know what? If they can make a béarnaise, they're laughing. If not, they're up the creek without a poodle.
I'm sick to the core. I feel very nervous about this, but I'm gonna smash it. Watch this space.
Guys, you have 50 minutes. 2 identical portions of your dish in appearance and in flavour.
Good luck.
You too.
We'll be fine.
OK, I'll give you a call.
We'll be fine.
You know the rules. Let's cook.
On the chicken cordon bleu, Monty and Zoe get straight to work on the time-consuming potatoes.
Cut them into cubes and put them in water.
In boiling water?
No, cold water.
OK.
With a bit of salt.
Right, OK.
You peel them, mate.
I'm peeling them now.
Peel, peel, peel. Chop, chop, chop. I'm such a reluctant leader, but Monty didn't know where the breast was on the chicken, so I think that sort of indicated that I might, in this very rare instant, have slightly more knowledge than somebody else.
How does this work?
You want nice cubes?
Yep.
About a centimetre by a centimetre.
Right, OK.
With the potatoes on to boil, their next challenge is to remove the breasts from the chicken.
My approach to this is very much stick a knife in and have a go. If you hit bone, you've gone too far. If you hit your own bone, you've really gone too far. Come on, let's get you out this, Cardi. Hiya, Monty!
I'm cutting the fillet.
Well done, mate.
I think I've cut it really well.
I think I'm doing all right. Well, I mean, I think... This chicken might disagree, but, you know, it's had worse days. Remember to put your corn on as well. That needs to go in boiling water.
On the beef steak, Gemma and Stephanie have managed to portion their fillets and wrap them in bacon.
I put some salt on my beef fillet before I wrapped it in bacon.
All right, I'll do the same. We're just going to cook the whole thing in the pan.
Yeah, we'll just do it at the end like we chatted about.
Right, the shallot for the fillet sauce, how do you cut it and put it in?
Should we make them pretty, like, pretty tiny?
So small bits, yeah?
Yeah.
Are you putting the whole shallot in? You need to tell me, because you look like you've made a sauce before.
Do you know what? Let's be safe. Let's go with half.
Half. Perfect.
How's it going, Gemma?
The bit I'm not understanding is saying whisk egg yolks and reduction over a bain-marie of boiling hot water. What's a bain-marie?
I think it's one of the glass pans, or see the glass bowls that you have?
But why have you got to do it over hot water?
Because I think the eggs will curdle, like you'll scramble them otherwise.
Steph's leading. It's all right, it's fine. I'm the leader everywhere else in my life. It's nice
Gemma,
to be led sometimes. Yeah?
Have you started your tarragon sauce?
Yeah. What does melt butter and cool and then strain reduction mean? How would you strain it?
Oh, I think by strain, they just mean take the big bits out.
Back on the red team, having successfully butchered their birds.
Right, I'm getting rid of that bit. You're off. Sorry, mate, you didn't make the grade.
Zoe and Monty now have to work out how to stuff the chicken.
Right, it's got a pocket now. Let's fill it.
I've not got a massive pocket.
Good, we're on the same page, because mine's not massive either.
Now, just shove it full of cheese and ham.
How many cheeses? Two or two slices?
I've put one and a bit.
Yep.
I've spent all of my life around food, and I've got no idea what a slice and a bit is. How are you going to quantify a bit to your partner?
I've put one and a half.
Their next job is the chicken coating.
OK, Zoe, how we do with the breadcrumbs?
Put your bread in the mixer, love.
All of it?
Ooh, don't do all of it.
I'll put a little bit in there. Let's see how it goes.
Which bit of this menu do you think you're going to have the biggest problem with? Because whatever you've got a problem with, he's going to have a problem with it,
no. I've never used one of these.
Are you telling me, with all this complex stuff, the thing that's bothering you the most is the breadcrumbs? Are you serious, Zoe?
Zoe's making her coating the traditional way. But Monty's taking a different approach.
Oh, beautiful breadcrumbs.
What's in there with your bread?
Bread, egg and flour.
Bread, egg and flour.
I'm very happy with this. Can't believe I got my breadcrumbs right.
What do your breadcrumbs look like, my love?
They're a little bit sticky with the egg and the thing on it, but hopefully with the frying bit, they'll melt into it.
And are they fine enough, do you think?
Yeah, they're fine enough. They're kind of, like, quite sticky.
They're sticky?
Yeah.
All right. Did you use your blender?
Yeah, I did.
And have you got your corn on?
Oh, what do I have to do with the corn?
Stick it in a large pan with boiling water.
OK.
I think it's going all right. It's a really odd way of cooking through a wall. Imagine what it must have been like, I don't know, in prison.
Over on the blue team, Gemma and Stephanie are both still working on their béarnaise to accompany their steaks.
You know the sauce
Yeah.
Are you whisking it over the hot water or off the hot water?
So right now I'm whisking it over the hot water.
What, with the batter in?
I've not put the butter in yet. So right now
I've just put the batter in. What should I do?
It says to start whisking butter in slowly until thick. Did you put all the butter in at once?
No.
I just think the big danger is that you don't want it to curdle. Gemma?
Yeah?
We've not chatted yet about the Swiss chard.
Pardon, darling?
We've not chatted yet about the green stuff.
Yeah, I've already got mine in steaming.
Okay, I'm just about to put my Swiss chard in.
It seems to be the teamwork of Gemma and Stephanie has disappeared completely. They seem to be going their own way rather than actually doing a dish together.
Do you know what? I think my sauce has come along lovely, if I'm honest. I'm in shock. I want to drink it myself. Mm. Oh, my goodness. Wowza, that is insane.
Do you know what Gemma's up to?
She was working on her beignets last time I spoke with her.
Mm.
And she'd already done her shard.
Mm.
Has she done her chips?
I don't think so yet.
Right. You see, you're working well as a team.
Do you know what? It is so much harder than I anticipated.
Lovely.
You've had 20 minutes.
Back on the red team, Zoe's making progress with her creamed corn.
I've never made creamed corn before, so I'm absolutely guessing at this point, but it can't be that hard. It's a staple of areas where corn is prevalent.
She's boiled the cobs and is removing the corn ready for the blender.
I'm all right at the moment. I have no idea what's happening back there, though, with Monty.
Tell me about your corn on the cob. How's that looking?
It's going in there right now.
It's going in?
One cob, right, and boiling hot water. OK, what about the onions? They get chopped up and they're put in the thing, right?
Well, we need to get your corn cooked first, mate. Your corn needs to be cooked first. It's going to take about 6 to 8 minutes to cook your corn.
Right, OK.
God, I thought we'd moved on from this, Monty.
Well, we had a... Yeah, I know.
Your potatoes?
Yeah?
We need to think about getting those on.
OK.
You should have cubes in front of you that have been patted dry, is that right?
Yes.
Right.
Zoe?
Yes, Monty?
Do we put the oil in the pan and with the rosemary and the potatoes?
Yes. Just make sure they're well coated, Monty.
Yeah, they're well coated, but I've also put oil in the pan as well.
That's fine, don't worry. We'll run with that.
OK.
The other team is also working on their potato accompaniment.
Steph?
Yeah?
How many potatoes are you cooking?
I only needed about not even half of a potato. The water's getting quite starchy, so I do think the cold water's supposed to leach some of the starch out, which will make it crispier.
Starch.
Make sure we dry it off really well. That'll just help them crisp up. Woo!
I've never used one of these machines before. Whoa, this is serious stuff. Will you let me know when to put the steak in?
I will, yeah. Maybe with 12 minutes to go, we'll do the steak, just so we have time to rest it.
Will you tell me?
I think that's wisest.
For me, that steak should be on now. It shouldn't be the last job they do, because that piece of meat should cook, and then it should rest.
You've got just 20 minutes left.
We need to get our chicken on.
Yeah, I know.
So, large pan, bit of butter in there. Let's get it cooking, because we're going to run out of time.
OK.
Come on, mate, cook. Everything should be coming together. Whether this chicken cooks or not in time is another thing. Monty?
Yes?
In a pan, you've got your shallot with some oil, yes?
Yes.
Add your corn.
Yes, I have.
All the corn that's off the cob.
Oh, I didn't do that. I put the whole corn in there.
So Zoe said to Monty, put the corn in the pan. So he's picked up the whole corn cob and stuck it in the pan.
How am I going to break these corn?
Get a knife.
Yeah.
Cut the corn off from top to bottom. It should come off in strips. Take it off the cob.
How close to yours do you think Monty's might be?
I have no idea at this stage how close Monty's will be to mine. I've asked him several times whether he's got his corn off the cob. I don't know if he has. I don't know if he knows what the cob is. I'm not sure at this point.
Oh, the bacon smells good. Is your bacon getting nice and crispy?
Yeah, absolutely fine. Do you know what? It's a beautiful bit of meat. A bit of black pepper. I wanted it tasty. I am used to cooking a good steak. I'd probably put it in the oven now.
Gemma, how's your bacon going?
I've actually put the steak in the oven, hung, so I was worried it was going to burn in the frying pan.
Oh, that's a really good idea. So should we just put the frying pan in the oven then, once the bacon's crispy?
Yes.
Oh, good shout. Okay. How long are you going to put yours in the oven for?
6 minutes.
6 minutes. Okay, cool. I'll do the same thing.
I've got mine on 180.
If you're going to pan fry a steak, it's the fastest way and the best way to cook, because you've got control, you can see what's going on with it. You put a steak in the oven and you can't see what's happening to it. It could dry it out.
Guys, you have 10 minutes.
Zoe, what's happening?
If only I knew, Monty, if only I knew. Talk to me about your potatoes. What's going on there, love?
OK, they're cooking up nicely, I think.
Lovely. And your chicken is cooking all the way through?
I think it's cooking.
It's quite a thick breast, so you make sure it's cooked all the way around.
I'll leave it in there for a little bit longer.
So you should have your shallots in a pan.
With the corn.
With the corn.
Yeah.
And a bit of the paprika.
I'll put a bit of paprika on it.
Mix that together. Make sure it's cooked. When it's cooked, stick it in your blitzer. We're going to cream it in a blitzer.
OK. Just put it all together and cream it, right?
Let me have a go. Let's see what happens. Hang on. Yeah, that'll work.
Right,
stick
okay.
it in your little blitzer, the one with the long handle sticking out the end.
Yeah, OK. So that should become like a puree?
Like a puree. The communication's been fairly one-way. Have there been gaps, I would say, in the communication? It's not very creamy, but it's definitely blitzed. I know what mine looks like. I have no idea what Monty's look like. Is your corn creamed?
Yeah, it's nice and pureed.
Beautiful, mate, beautiful.
You've got 4 minutes. Whatever you're going to do has got to be done in 4 minutes.
What plate have you decided to put your food on?
A bowl.
Cool.
Are you getting your food on the plate?
Yeah.
Awesome. And then when we have 1 minute to go, I'm gonna put my beef onto the plate and put a dollop of béarnaise on the beef.
Beautiful.
You have 60 seconds left.
It's a bit more cordon brown, to be honest. Oh, hello. So have you cut your chicken in half and you've got the corn at the side?
I've got my chicken on the plate.
Beautiful.
Right, guys, your time is up.
Done.
Breadcrumbs I'm not too sure about, but I think it should be all right.
I do like me sauce. I'm pleased with me sauce. Mmm.
Bread team, up you come. Okay.
Not too bad, is it?
Yeah.
No, I had all sorts of images in my head.
Actually, when you look at these, apart from the colour on the chicken, because obviously one chicken's got breadcrumbs, the other one's got breakfast cereal, they actually look pretty similar.
Yeah.
Zoe, what you didn't see is behind the wall, Monty had the eggs, the flour and the breadcrumbs all in the blender.
Ah.
So where did I go wrong?
Yeah, they should be separate.
But you both successfully took the breast off a whole chicken.
Yeah.
And you did a great job of it. We wanted cream corn, and you both seem to have done that. That's great. I mean, even after a bit of instruction, you finally took the corn off the cob.
Yes.
Which is great.
I am really impressed with the outcome of both of these dishes. The only issue, as I can see, is this breadcrumb affair.
Yeah.
It's kind of more like an uncrispy batter. But once that's come off, everything else is superb.
I really like your cream corn, Monty. It's lovely and moist because there's lots of butter in it. Your chicken's cooked nicely and it's still wonderfully moist. I like your little tiny cubed potatoes, and they could probably do with a sprinkle of salt, but the rosemary's there and it's great. Zoe, you've got it right on song. You've done really, really well. Generous, tasty, crumbed properly. You guys, under pressure, did really well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
They were quite positive comments we got at the end, huh?
I was quite surprised, actually, how they felt.
I think they were quite surprised.
Yeah, they were surprised. This could have gone completely off the scale.
Blue team, steak and chips.
It looks lovely.
Okay.
Fascinating.
You guys, somehow or another, the communication stopped at some stage, but you know what? You've both got it played up, and I think they look pretty close to each other.
Is that how you wanted it?
Medium rare.
I'd say that's very rare.
Very rare.
Yeah. A little rare for me, but it wouldn't stop me eating it.
How do you like your steak, Gemma?
Just like that.
Perfect, then.
Yep.
Your beef is cooked nicely. It's how you want it. Rare. It's got great seasoning. Your chard is cooked really well. Your fries are fantastic and well-seasoned. The issue here is the béarnaise. It's split, and that's a real shame.
Yeah, why did it go like that?
Used whole eggs. It's egg yolks. It's not whole eggs.
Oh, I meant to just use the orange bit.
That's right. So the white's cooked, and that's why you got a little bit of scramble. But the flavour was great.
Stephanie, your béarnaise is fantastic. Creamy, sharp, really lovely. I love the chard. I love your straw potatoes. I think you've done brilliantly, brilliantly well.
You haven't seasoned as heavily as Gemma has. You can afford a bit more pepper.
OK.
But your béarnaise is fab. I think you guys should be really impressed with yourselves. Really impressed.
You always need to be prepared for anything. Like, at no point in this competition can you kind of let your guard down or let your effort down. And I need a really good night's sleep.
I need a brandy. I'm exhausted. Please,
we want you to learn about teamwork. Because you've got a big challenge coming. If you all manage to work together, you could be flying. Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen.
It's early morning, and Gemma, Monty, Stephanie, and Zoe are travelling towards Heathrow.
Right, we are going to an airport and we're dishing up plain food.
I reckon it's canteen cooking. Hungry bag handlers.
Good morning and welcome to the incredible British Airways Global Learning Academy. This is where they train cabin crew, engineers, and of course, pilots. Over 200,000 people come through this centre every single year. Today, you are going to cook lunch for 120 of them.
This is all about teamwork and communication. So we are going to split you into teams. Monty and Stephanie, you're a team. Zoe and Gemma, you're a team.
Hooray!
Yay! I suggest you four fasten your seatbelts, get yourself down to business, and cook something first class.
People? Gosh, that's like serving a lot of people there, and I don't know how it's going to go.
Do you know what? I'm going to roll my sleeves up and bang them out. Bang them dinners out.
I hope they've got big pots. I'm hoping for big pots.
The celebrities will be working under head chef Frank Coughlan.
Here's all your ingredients, OK? I'm going to give you 5-6 minutes to write your recipes or your ideas, and then we'll start the preparation, OK? Let's get going.
Each team will have 2.5 hours to create 50 meat or fish and 25 vegetarian main courses, as well as 70 portions of dessert. The larder includes Cumberland sausages, minced beef, chicken thighs, a range of fruit and vegetables, and a selection of herbs and spices.
You might not agree, but straight away my brain's going sausage and mash and onion gravy. Beautiful.
What we could do also is a sausage casserole.
Brilliant idea, Zoe.
Brilliant.
Yes. Because at least then it's a big old pot or something.
They're getting their vegetables, they're getting their meat.
We could do some lovely little new potatoes with it.
No, or Delphine Wild potatoes with the cheese on top and the cream. That's luxury.
Can you make it?
Well, I'll have a go.
So the chicken, I'm thinking we want to do some sort of marinade on it.
We've got all herbs and spices here.
Oh, maybe we could do roast chicken and gravy then? And then, well, in terms of potatoes, do you want to do a mash or a roast potato? I mean, everyone loves a roast.
Yeah.
But I think a mash is just, in terms of mass cooking, might be easier.
Why don't we do nice rice filled in a pepper? Zoe, are you loving life right now?
I'm experiencing it to the max.
So where are we up to with your lunch?
Yeah. I'm going to make a cauliflower potato curry.
Lovely.
She's going to make roast chicken.
And then we're going to do some cheesy mashed potatoes.
OK.
I was thinking of making a posset.
Yeah?
Double cream, whip it up, put them in jars.
Bang, bang. Perfect.
Can we do a crumble? I can make custard. I know
apple
how to make custard.
Crumble.
Do you know how to make an apple crumble?
No, but you're going to tell me.
There is enough talent in each team to get this done, but they have to work together.
I've given Steph the permission to get really brutal with me.
Our teams have to be able to decide who's going to be leader and who's going to take the orders.
Right, you be in charge of the casserole, I'll be in charge of the potato, Delphine was.
Right, OK.
They are going to have to really buckle down. They are going to have to navigate their way through some stormy skies.
Right, how many people are we cooking for?
You need 50 of your potato.
I've got to peel 50 potatoes.
We've got potato dauphinoise, sausage casserole, we've got some stuffed peppers, we've got couscous going inside those, and then for dessert, we've got an apple crumble and custard. I love the menu. I think the menu is wonderful.
Excuse me, all jokes aside, I physically don't think I could peel 50 potatoes. Have you got a machine?
No, don't be so silly.
Have you got one of them fast?
We've got a speed peeler. Yeah, we'll get you a speed peeler.
Can I have that, please, Chef?
With a mountain to climb, Gemma finds a way to speed things up.
Just help me peel the potatoes, I can do the rest. But try and make sure all the stuff's, like, literally off of it, darling. I've never peeled so many potatoes in all my life. We've got these fancy machines that do it, innit?
Right, Gemma, it's you doing the competition, isn't it? Don't do too much for it. You're not meant to be doing it.
Genuinely, chef,
yes.
I am. Keep going, Amir, keep going.
Meanwhile, teammate Zoe has started to prepare onions and garlic, which will form the base of the sausage casserole.
About 10 people, that's probably the most I've ever cooked for. And then it would be one pot wonder. With some sort of base layer under that, rice that's turned to asbestos, something like that. So I have literally no idea how many onions or bits of garlic I should be doing. I'm just doing them all.
What's the division of labour?
We kind of split it even, Stevens, I think. I'm taking charge of the casserole. Gemma's doing the potato dauphinoise because she likes that. The peppers, I'm leaving to her. And then crumble, I'm going to be doing the custard. I'm going to need her to help me cook the apples. I've never actually made a crumble.
Sorry, you've never made a crumble before?
No.
Have you ever made crumble before, Gemma?
Never. Desserts wasn't our strong point. I'm not sure if we have a strong point, but desserts was definitely our weakest weak point.
Right, guys, come on, we need to start moving it, OK?
Right, Sally, you need to hurry up.
Across the kitchen, the red team is already hard at work. Monty's got his cream sugar posset mix on the boil, which will be flavoured with lemons.
How many lemons do I have to zest?
12, 16 lemons. OK. Wait, what are you doing?
Oh, this is hard work. My arm hurts.
Did you not use to bowl?
Yeah.
Well, surely you should have arm muscles then.
I'm not used to this.
Teammate Stephanie has taken charge of the roast chicken main.
So at the moment, I've got about 100 chicken thighs here that we're marinating. We've got some rosemary and thyme and some olive oil and salt and pepper. And then we're going to get started on the yummy mashed potatoes, which is their official name. OK. It was actually really satisfying.
Sarah, why don't you just get the squeeze on? Just go.
What's this? Your hand's good enough.
That's too much work, mate.
Just do it. Jeez.
Monty, we are seeing two things that you've booked before.
Yeah.
The potato and cauliflower curry.
Yeah.
Lemon posset. But last time was one portion of each.
Yeah, and now it's going to be 25.
And how many portions of dessert?
70.
That's a lot of posset.
Yes.
That's a lot of lemons.
Yes, and it's quite hard work, actually, zesting a lemon. I didn't realise.
Are we going to have a biscuit or something with it?
Yeah, a biscuit could work, if we've got enough time. Yeah, we'll add a biscuit.
Curry, what's going with it? Rice, chapatis?
Well, if you want me to make chapatis, I can do that as well.
Look, the deal is, okay. Get the bulk of your work done.
Yeah.
When you've done that, there's bells and whistles you can put on the side, but your posset's going to need a biscuit or something, isn't it? A tub of posset.
Can you work and talk? Yeah. Can you work and talk? Come on.
OK, sorry, we work and talk as well.
Yeah.
Stephanie and Monty are being quite tactical.
I need a peeler.
They're doing stuff that they know, and they know very, very well, and they're just going to do it a little bit more special. Fantastic.
45 minutes have gone, and Gemma's made a cream sauce for her dauphinoise.
Nice!
And hollowed out her peppers, ready for stuffing with couscous and courgettes.
It's just backbreaking, chopping courgettes. This isn't normal. There is a machine that you stick the courgette in and it does it for you. Like, do these people even know this?
Gemma, all right,
listen,
what are we up to?
Listen, I'm done. All no. I've literally got right, to do, so, you don't understand, I'm a very fast person.
But they're not finished right. Look, you've got all seeds in them.
Yeah, but I'm going to get them out in a minute.
Do one job at a time.
Yeah, but I'm creative.
You're not, you're a nightmare.
I'm creative.
Right, do one job at a time. No wonder you're done so quickly. Gemma gets the jobs finished before they've even started, and she can talk more than she can work.
They're going to love this. Do you know why?
All right, stop talking and do this.
Yeah, do you know why? Because I've put my heart
into it.
While Gemma tidies her peppers, Zoe's managed to chop onions and carrots for her casserole, but her next challenge is to sear off 150 sausages.
And get them coloured on the outside, OK?
It's just the sheer quantity. It sounds so easy in your head when you say you're going to do something. This isn't even half my sausage that I'm having to brown before I put it in the oven. It's a little bit intimidating. I reckon after today, my banger spinning skills will be second to none.
On the other team, Stephanie has started prep for the mashed potato, which will accompany her chicken thighs.
I may actually be the world's slowest peeler. I think we've gone with 60 potatoes in the end, so like a potato a person. Whew. Things that you think are gonna take 5 minutes, I mean, it's taking like half an hour, and so that kind of worries me because maybe all of our timings are off. So I'm making actually one of my favorite things. I've just ever made it on MASH. We call them yummy mashed potatoes. It's actually a recipe I took from my husband's grandma. You mash the potatoes, grate in some onion, sour cream, cheese, mix it up, put them in casserole tins, cheese on top, and then bake it. You know, I've never known anyone to not like them.
Beautiful.
Awesome.
Ooh, that's really hot. I think the posset's finished.
Okay, are you gonna put the lemon in?
Yeah. All the good stuff.
Right. Okay, pour them in. And then we've got to get them in the chiller.
Could you do this while I just cut the other stuff over there?
Yeah, you go for it. Once I put my potatoes in, I can do that.
Yeah, this is self-explanatory. Yeah, 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 we know what we're doing.
Teamwork.
Save us one of them, because they're lovely. Have you ever tried lemon posset? It's amazing.
Having left Stephanie with the rest of his posset prep, Monty moves on to chopping veg for his cauliflower and potato curry.
I think I'm okay. I'm just trying to work out the portions.
Monty.
Yes, sir.
Now, how do you scale up that cauliflower curry?
I had one cauliflower, and that was for like, I think, 2, 3, 4 people at home. So when I make cauliflower at home, which is my mum, dad,
and my brother and my dog called Rambo.
Dog Rambo.
So now I had to go by 6 times, which is 25. So I had to 6 cauliflowers, 6 potatoes, 6 onions. That's how I scaled it up. So if I got 6...
No, you needed an abacus to do it. You took so long.
Have I got the maths right there?
You were slow.
Yeah, but Frank, I just can't live with this pace. I'm trying to think of a word to describe Frank. I'll probably say he's demanding.
Monty.
Yes.
Come and take your possets and put them in the chiller. This was your idea and you ain't touched them. Put them in the chiller. In here. Monty's in another world. He's in Cloud Cuckoo. They'll fit on the shelf, so they'll be fine going on there. OK, go and get the rest of them.
OK.
Chef has been doing his pieces at Monty.
Come on, run, Monty.
But he's got one gear, and it's almost reverse.
Awesome, thank you.
Isn't that how to live life?
And the others?
Just have a chit-chat and just
no,
easy sale.
It. Come on.
All right.
I don't think we're going to make lunch. Oh, we might, but I don't know what it's going to be like, so... Yeah.
This is the captain. This is an emergency. Brace, brace.
Throughout the training academy, classes are well underway.
All exits are clearly marked...
Over 200,000 staff, including cabin crew, pilots and engineers, train here every year.
In their training, the safety is of paramount importance.
Brace, brace!
But we're also training them on service skills, medical as well, that we have to look at. So it's a very, very intensive period of learning.
This high-tech facility includes 16 flight simulators, giving pilots experience of landing in the harshest of conditions anywhere in the world.
All of them are working in some shape or form physically.
Unfasten your seatbelts, wait!
It's incredibly important. They really need to get a wholesome meal, make sure they're as sharp in the afternoon as they were when they arrived in the morning.
Right, Gem, I need you to get the apples peeled now, OK?
With an hour to go, Gemma has again roped in the sous chef, this time to make a start on the apple crumble.
Thanks, honey.
Gemma's used a few of my chefs more than the others. Actually, she's used both of them all the time.
Give me a hug. Amazing.
Good luck.
Have a little rest, yeah. Don't overwork yourself.
Meanwhile, she's been frying off the courgettes and made some spiced couscous for the stuffed peppers.
Right, check the seasoning, please.
Yeah, I've done it. This bloke don't believe me. I'm all done. All I've literally got to do, put the courgettes in with the couscous, stick in the peppers, they're done, boil apples. That was my part of the bargain. So he's making the casserole. So far, my work is done.
Teammate Zoe's workload is far from over. She's finished browning the 150 sausages, but still has to cook the carrot, onion and tomato sauce base for her casserole.
Precision is all important when you're dealing on this scale.
Go nice with the dauphinoise, this will. It's the crumble I worry about.
You're worried about it?
Oh, tell me about it. Right.
I've never made one before. Gemma seems to be really cool, calm and collected, which makes me really worried. I'm leaving it in the lap of the gods.
OK, guys, we've got 45 minutes.
We still have some time. Like, it's going to get pretty intense soon.
Stephanie's managed to get the potatoes for her mash onto boil and has made a start on a blueberry compote, which will spruce up their possets. But there's one dish that's far from ready.
Monty is just finishing up chopping. He's got the curry. He needs to get it on soon, though, because it's going to take a good... Like, he needs to get that on in the next 5 minutes. So, actually, I should really go over and help him. Are we going to do a rice to go with the curry as well?
Oh, yeah, he wanted a side.
We need to get some rice on.
OK, do you know how to make rice?
Sure.
Huh?
Yeah.
Right, then go ahead with it.
OK, I'm going to make rice.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, we haven't got enough time.
We need to get that curry on the go now.
No.
What do you mean, no?
I need the oil. Where's the vegetable oil?
Oil's in it.
Okay, one sec. I'll put this, that, then that.
Come on, it's okay. Today. No rush, Monty, no rush at all. Do you want me to give you a smaller spoon? You can take longer doing it.
Sorry, I've got to get the thingy right. I need the stuff now, quickly.
Oi, Gemma, get back up there.
Go on, put it all in there. Put it all in there now. That's it. And I need to chop tomatoes. How much do you put in there?
You'll need all of it in there.
Really?
OK, pull the top down now.
Hopefully, they'll be happy with that.
There's only 30 minutes left.
I'm not letting you down, Zoe.
And with Gemma's peppers stuffed and Zoe's casserole left to simmer, they both come together for the crumble.
Right, guys, doing the crumble mix and the custard.
This is just laborious. It's just stir, isn't it?
Yeah.
You all right, ladies?
Yeah.
Are you on time?
Done.
Zoe, what is the big issue?
The timings and the quantities. I'm doing a bucket load of custard, mate, right as we
Are you not worried about anything at all?
No.
Nothing?
No. Just that they enjoy it. Should I be worried about something?
Let's not worry, let's enjoy.
We've got to feed 70.
So, what are you thinking?
Will we have enough?
Yeah.
Just sprinkle blackberries in there, Gemma, yeah? I've only got a bowl kit.
Don't worry. Chill.
Right, Gemma, let's get the topping on.
How do I put that on there? I need a spoon.
God gave you hands, didn't he?
How much crumble are you putting on there? Don't put too much, because it'll just be all crumble, love. We're not tarmacking. It's not a driveway.
Sorry, I finished the crumble, darling.
Great.
Right, chef, I want to get these in the oven. How do I do it? Thanks.
So I'm just making the mashed potato, and then we got to get it into the oven. Having to guess on a lot of the portions, but it's okay. I mean, it's really, really hard to mess up mash. Like, really hard.
Right, are you doing anything with that, or are you going to eat that on its own?
Rice.
Rice?
Yeah.
Right. Do you want some cardamom seeds with the rice, Chef?
We haven't decided. I need to speak to Steph about that.
Well, come on. It's today. They're having it.
Oh, right, OK.
I'm fastening your seatbelts and come this way.
In 20 minutes, this morning's training sessions will come to an end.
So we only have a short window of opportunity to actually feed our colleagues. It's really important that we make sure that these people are well fed,
right.
On time, and that they're back to the classroom, because we have so much to get through to ensure that we continue to run a safe airline. That becomes critical for us.
Zoe, how's your custard? Make sure it don't split, yeah?
Yeah.
OK.
I think this is enough. Are our crumbles in?
Done.
Sorry,
it's all done.
The one thing we did say, Gemma, I don't know whether we can do a big thing of salad to put a little bit on the side of the peppers. Look at your face, it's telling me no.
Sorry, I'm just sleeping behind my eyes a minute. Right, no, it won't, because they've got the Delph and Wiles potatoes with it as well. That was my plan.
Right.
Hey, Gemma.
Yeah?
I thought you were doing a little salad to go with the pepper.
Well, I wasn't, actually. I was going to give them some Delph and Wiles potatoes.
But you won't have enough, I don't think, for both, will you, darling?
70 people.
Reluctantly, Gemma swings into action.
Bring me lemons, cucumber.
She's good at bossing everyone around.
I want feta cheese and a big pot.
Yeah, a bit of a queen.
Bit of red onion.
Yeah, all right, all right. I'm in charge, not you.
Olives.
Yeah, wait a minute.
And any anchovies or not?
That's no, vegetarian. Like vegetarian, you can't have.
Oh, don't eat fish, no.
While Gemma gathers ingredients for her salad...
Thanks, honey. Any black olives?
Stephanie is also making a last-minute addition.
OK, so I need some sugar and some oats. And do you have any nuts?
What are you making here?
OK, so I'm attempting to do a crumble for the top of the compote.
OK.
Now is not the time to decide your dish needs something else. That decision should have been made hours ago. Slightly nervous.
What?
Slightly nervous of you guys getting lunch out for everybody. You're supposed to be serving in 10 minutes.
So shall I check the curry? The potatoes are not even cooked.
No, you can't. Right, let's get it on the tray. We've got 5 minutes. Come on!
Do you know what I'm thinking as well, Chef?
No, it worries me.
Would you like me to wash up, Chef?
No, I want you to tidy your mess up. We've got to start getting the serving dishes ready now. Get your rice in the container. Right, let's go. Right, so this would be your station. OK, so
you've got... Up.
Yeah.
I'm joking. I've got to cook and serve.
Well, you didn't do much cooking, did you? Let's be honest.
Oh, my God. There's a lot of people.
We've had a busy day, so I'm hoping that the food is good because I am really ready for something nice to eat.
Release the hounds.
Oh, our first customer. I'm really well. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
How was your flight?
Good. What would you like, my love?
Sausage and potato.
Sausage and potato. Beautiful.
There's an immediate rush for Zoe's sausage casserole.
There you go, sir. Hello. Who's next?
Which is being served with Dauphinoise potatoes and Greek salad.
I'm giving you tomato with your creamy potatoes.
Thank you very much.
Sausage, bit of potato with it?
Please.
Might want to grab a plate, Gemma. Start.
Yeah, sure. Cool. Dauphinoise are insane, and I made them.
Gravy with your bangers. There you go. Enjoy, my friend.
Thank you very much.
They look really happy with the food, if I'm honest.
The casserole was really rich, and the Dauphinoise potatoes were so creamy. I thought it was lovely. I could have eaten a whole bowl.
The sausage casserole with Greek salad is probably a weird combination. I don't think they intended for people to get that. It worked. The sausage casserole was heartwarming.
Potatoes are cooked really nice, they're lovely and soft, really well seasoned. You've got quite a strong, salty gravy. Carrots are cooked nicely. Sausages are cooked very, very well.
Hi, how are you? Chicken? Amazing.
Across the canteen, Stephanie's rosemary chicken, served with cheese and onion mash and peas, is also a huge draw. Good.
Chicken?
Yes, please.
Would you like some potatoes?
Yes, please.
I really hope you enjoy it.
The chicken was cooked perfectly. It was moist. It had lots of flavour added. I particularly like the cheese on top of the mash. It's lovely.
The potatoes, whatever the special ingredient was, whatever they did, worked really well.
John, it's an old-fashioned British dinner, and it's lovely. Moist thighs, gravy, loads of rosemary across the chicken. That is perfect. Absolutely perfect.
Apparently it was self-serve. Right, what do you want?
There are fewer takers for the vegetarian mains, but Gemma's courgette and spicy couscous stuffed peppers are the more popular choice.
Stuffed pepper? One or two?
One, please.
With?
Hello,
lovely. Nice bit of salad, yeah? I hope you like these, because I made these. There you are, babe.
That's perfect.
Thank you.
Couscous was fine, not so sure about the pepper. It was hard. the BA knife couldn't cut through it very well.
the pepper could do with some more cooking, but I like the sweetness of the peppers, and I like the flavour they got in the couscous. They've got tomato in there, they've got a little bit of spice, big chunks of fresh, raw veg. I like that.
Rice and veggie
curry. I really
hope
you enjoy it.
Monty's cauliflower and potato curry, served with rice, has seen the least interest.
Everyone's loving the chicken at the moment, but I'm sure there'll be someone turning up for a bit of vegetarian curry. £2.50, portion of curry. Yeah.
Monty, you need to sell your products. Look, they're all queuing over there. Go down the line, Monty.
All right.
And get them come and eat here.
Vegetarian cauliflower curry, if anybody wants it, please. Come and join the queue. We would love you to try some mixed herb curry. Yes.
Curry?
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Cauliflower curry was nice, but the rice didn't have any flavour whatsoever. It was really undercooked, average at best.
The rice was a little bit underdone. I found it a little bit chalky at the end, and I'll be honest, the potatoes were a little bit under as well, but the taste was fantastic.
He knows how to make the cauliflower curry, does our Monty, and it's a good curry. It was good last time, it's good again.
Moorish, addictive, but Monty found it very hard to sell that.
Come on, it's not over. Let's get cleared up now. We've got dessert to do. Looks good.
Thank you, Frank.
Right, we're ready.
Ladies and gentlemen, dessert is served.
Come forward.
Hello, my friends.
Hello, how are you? What would you like, darling?
Gemma and Zoe are offering an apple and blackberry crumble with custard.
Custard and crumble?
Thank you very much.
Somebody's got a mega load of crumble here.
They've been working hard. They need some nice food in them.
There we go, my love. Enjoy.
Thank you very much.
Hey, let's get ready to crumble.
It was a bit bland. It needed some cinnamon or spices to perk it up.
The custard was just slightly a little bit too runny. It would have been nice if it had been a little bit thicker, but it tasted beautiful. It was really nice.
Vanilla custard, a little bit of sweet top, buttery and a bit sugary. The apple's a bit sharp. I like the blackberries in it. But the texture is gone to pieces. The texture is a swamp.
Monty and Stephanie's dessert seems to be drawing in the crowds.
Lemon posset with granola and blueberry compost.
No, no, no. That is something totally different. It is not a compost. Granola on top.
Thank you.
Enjoy.
The lemon posset worked really well with the blueberries on top. They weren't too sweet, not too sour.
The blueberry compote did accompany it, and also the granola on the top was excellent.
It's really sweet, and there's not quite enough lemon in it to make it sharp. But I do like the blueberry and the oats across it.
The other team's dessert, the lemon posset, looked glorious. I wish I'd had the lemon posset.
Chef, give me a kiss, because I have smashed your kitchen into another dimension today, haven't we, Zoe?
Good team.
Bam.
I need a drink now.
Did smash it. Well done.
No, it's been fun. It's been good. It's been nice. It's been enjoyable. I wouldn't want to do this every day.
Feeling relieved and a bit pleased with ourselves, I think. We did all right. I think it's been another little mini miracle.
I just totally smashed it. But I think Zoe deep down knows I'm a woman of my word.
I don't realise how much effort and concentration and all that sort of mental energy that goes into it. I feel really exhausted right now.
I've started to trust myself more and trust my instincts. Stephanie, you can do this, and you can put out nice food. I'm not going to say great food, but nice food.
In all, our celebs have learned a huge amount. But from here on in, it's individual task time. And it's time for them to take off and face the next round.
After 2 days of competition, these four celebrities face one more challenge. At the end, two of them will be going home.
I'm seriously feeling like I need to sleep for another 2-3 days before I do this next task. But got to crack on.
My brain says you can't do this on an hourly, if not minute-to-minute basis.
It's just literally walking into that kitchen. I don't know what it is about that place.
Today is back to me being on my own, but do you know what? I'm hoping to go in there and smash it.
Right now is the time to deliver your best food in the competition so far, because you are cooking for a place in MasterChef semi-finals. You are going to present your food to a finalist and two winners of Celebrity MasterChef. Rylan, Kimberly Wyatt, and Lisa Faulkner. You've got two courses, four plates of each course, 1 hour and 15 minutes to do it in. At the end of this, two of you will be going home. Ladies and gentlemen, let's cook.
Just hope I can create something that they think is reasonably tasty. That's what I'm going for. I've set the bar quite low, haven't I? Just don't kill them, so that'll be really bad PR.
What are your two courses?
My main course is a Goan prawn and pumpkin coconut curry. I like it spicy. I eat it hot at home, so you're going to have to suck it up and eat it hot here as well. And then for my dessert, I'm doing a chocolate orange cake with an orange liqueur custard. It's quite intense.
What about presenting your food to the three fantastic cooks in the back room?
I feel really nervous. Really nervous. They're proper foodies. So they're going to be looking at it with a really keen eye. I just want to bring my cooking skills up to my level of eating abilities. That's all I want to do.
Zoe's menu, I think, sounds absolutely fantastic. Goan prawn curry, which means it's going to be lovely and creamy, lots and lots of coriander. Rice on the side, as well as some naan. Little flatbreads, hollow in the middle, but soft on the outside. It could be really delicious, but she's got a lot of work to do. Followed by chocolate orange cake. I love chocolate and orange together. I think that's really good. I mean, it's crowd-pleasing food.
That's one thing I'll say about this show. I did think I worked hard. There's something about MasterChef that breaks you to the next level. I feel like I've been building 20 houses every time I leave here.
Gemma, two courses. What are you going to make for us?
So today I'm making a sea bass en papillote.
Yeah.
It's going to be amazing.
En papillote, you've got it inside a paper parcel.
Yeah.
What's inside that paper parcel to flavour the fish?
There's courgettes, there's carrots, there's tomatoes, there's olives, there's lemon.
Yum.
And then I'm making a white chocolate cheesecake with raspberries. I've never cooked a cheesecake before. And I thought, why not test myself today?
Hang on a minute. You must have practiced at home.
I practiced once. My best friend Jack came over and I said, look, I need help with a dessert. So he's like, hey, let me show you how to do this. So I watched him and this is what I'm putting into practice now.
Her mate came round and cooked it while she watched. I've watched loads of people play snooker, tennis, rugby and football, but it doesn't mean I can do it. Very little can go wrong with that fish in the parcel. As long as the vegetables are all cut really thinly, so that fish is going to cook really quickly, which means the vegetables have to cook quickly as well. So they've got to be quite thin.
Sometimes I get so frustrated at myself for just caring too much about really ridiculous things. Just everything. I just want to do the best that I can. And that takes its toll. You know, it's really hard. I'm doing kind of a Japanese-flavoured salmon on a crispy salmon skin. And then I think the best way to describe it is an open-faced California roll with coconut rice on the bottom, which will be sweet, but it's with the intent of taking away some of the kick from the spicy mayo. And then there's an edamame and avocado mash and then a seaweed salad on top.
Brilliant.
So my dessert is going to be a chocolate mocha fondant with vanilla whipped cream.
So you're taking a risk on a dish which has got a reputation for going wrong. At a stage, we're looking for a semi-final place.
I am.
Whoa, Stephanie is really going for it. We've got salmon being cooked in a water bath first, so it takes the flavour of the sesame oil. She sent an open California roll, which means flattened seaweed with lots of rice, which is going to be flavoured with mirin, because that's where you get the flavour of the sushi from. And then she's making a mash of avocado and edamame. I think it sounds absolutely fantastic. I've never had anything like it before in my life. It sounds like a modern restaurant dish. Fondant has to be crispy on the outside with a very, very oozy running centre.
Doesn't matter how many medals you've won in the past, how hard you want to work, this is technical stuff. Wow, what has happened to Monty? He's really going up a notch. He is having a go at a biryani, beautiful spiced rice dish.
Biryani, I've done it a couple of times. Bob's my dad, Bob the Builder. He's a builder, so we call him Bob. I go, Bob, come downstairs, have a taste of this. He said it's delicious. But I didn't really trust him because last time I gave Bob the curry, I burnt it, and he goes, oh, this tastes great as well. And then Mom came in and she goes, this is terrible.
But he's serving that with a dal, soft, wet lentils, and a green chutney. John, if he gets that right, that's a delicious combination.
I think that could be fantastic. And then he's making chocolate mousse. And on top of that, he's got tempered chocolate going across the top in an arch. If he gets this right, I'm going to be really impressed.
I think I'm all right. I think I'm in time. I think everything is cooking on time.
You today have changed gear, Monty.
Yeah.
You seem a little bit more urgent. You've got a bit more urgency.
Yeah, I think I'm just got used to the pace you need to be at the kitchen. Okay.
I remember at this point in the competition, you're still trying to get used to the kitchen and get your flow and wanting to impress the judges. You're faced with the mountain that you've got to climb and you've got to get out on top. But it's easier said than done.
The thing that really impresses me, if somebody's made that extra bit of effort and you can see that, there are signs that somebody's really tried and you taste something and you go, oh my gosh, that's amazing. That's what I'm looking for.
If you get over this hurdle, that's when you get that little inkling in your head, right, OK, well, I can get that little bit further now, and you're edging ever closer to that final.
Well, well, well.
So this round, for me, was the one that you really want to impress in.
Cheers!
Cheers, everyone.
Well done, winners.
Well done, Raylan.
You have just 15 minutes on your main course, Zoe.
Okie dokie.
On time?
I think so.
First course is Goan prawn and pumpkin coconut curry, served with coriander rice, cucumber salad, and naan bread.
Mmm.
Yum.
As long as it's got them right flavours in it.
All right, prawn mates, here we go. We're going in. Bye-bye.
Hopefully the prawns won't be overcooked. Nothing worse than an overcooked prawn.
Zoe, you got 7 minutes.
Yeah.
Your bread looks like dough at the moment.
Yes, it is dough.
Will that cook, like, in minutes?
That will cook in minutes.
That's really good, because that's all you got.
That is all I've got.
It's difficult to do bread and make it amazing.
Don't ruin the naan.
Don't ruin the naan.
Come on, you can do this. How's your bread? Breads are toasting, breads are toasting.
Come on, breads.
Looks great, Zoe.
That's lovely.
Go, Zoe.
Hi.
Hi.
I've cooked for you a prawn goan coconut and pumpkin curry with a little cooling cucumber on the side, coriander rice, and a naan bread. Enjoy.
Thank you.
I'm a bit worried about the naan because it doesn't look completely cooked all the way through, but I'm excited about all these flavors together. It looks lovely.
I think the curry is delicious. I love the flavours. I love the prawn.
I get a bit of spice kind of popping through here and there. And the cooling cucumber just accents it perfectly.
The naan, it is undercooked, but because it's so thin, it still tastes quite nice. Mm. I think she's done a really good job, especially within the time.
The prawns themselves, I quite like, because they're nice and crunchy. I like the consistency of the sauce and the sweet pumpkin. The naan, for me, wants to be cooked a little bit more. But I think it's a great effort, and she's on her way. There you go, Zoe. Brilliant. Right, you've got 15 minutes on your dessert. What do you got left to do?
Custard.
Chocolate orange cake with Contro custard.
You don't like that?
I don't like orange and chocolate together.
But it could be just those hints of orange in a lovely bit of chocolate would be fantastic.
That's enough? Wow, that's a lot.
Oh, that does smell good, though. My eyes are watering.
Zoe, where's your cake?
Cake's in the oven. Here we go.
Aye, aye. How do you know they're cooked all the way down to the bottom?
If I'd been in there for 45 minutes, I'd be done all the way through.
Nice, nice, nice.
I've got nothing else, Greg. I've given everything, mate. There's nothing else in the tank.
Fabulous.
OK.
Fabulous. Go on, Zoe.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. I haven't killed you, so that's good.
No.
You're still here.
That's pretty.
So what I've made you for dessert is an orange chocolate cake with an orange liqueur custard on the side.
Thank you.
This is what we wanted.
Yes. It looks beautiful. It does.
And I can
love
smell it.
It
from here as well, which is a really good sign. Oh.
Oh.
Oh, wow.
Oh, delicious.
This will be in my veneers for weeks, but it's so worth it.
Oh, I could eat all of this.
I'm gonna.
I'm not sure about the custard.
I'm with you.
The cake is unbelievable.
I don't think it needs the custard. Mm-mm. This is really, really tough to get that consistency, that moisture, and it's so warming.
This is the first time that I have enjoyed chocolate orange together. I mean, I smashed it, just melted in the mouth, and then you just get that hint on the back of your tongue of the orange. It
works. You had the orange in the background going, I'm here, but I don't want to be front of stage.
Yes.
I like this because the orange isn't sweet. And that's a really nice accompaniment to the rich, rich chocolate.
And relax. I hope the Pathfinders can see that I've made an effort. Even if it didn't hit the spot, at least I've tried.
Come on! Good job.
Go, Gemma!
Right.
The fact that it says Mediterranean sea bass on papillote, I'm hoping that there's some Mediterranean vegetables in there. You have to make sure that your timing's right, that you're not going to overcook that fish or the vegetables. I wonder if she'll keep it in the paper.
You open it up. Prison.
Yeah, and you open it up and it's got that lovely steam.
So you could have a sea bass and a facial.
Or at the same time.
Beautiful.
A fish facial.
My type of fish.
I just need me scissors, because I like to present things nice. I suppose the paper adds to the drama of the dish. It can go out a bit rustic.
Yeah.
Done.
OK, let's get this out.
Thanks, sorry. So, today I've made sea bass on Pappy Pot. Oh, no, on papillote. Yeah. And I hope you love it.
Thanks, Jen.
Thank you.
That's not what you were expecting, is it?
That is potato, isn't it? It's not paper.
It looks like it's been through a brine site. Like, there's little bits of paper in my fish.
Actually, the fish is really beautifully cooked. It's really nice. Sadly, all my vegetables are raw. But the fish is lovely.
I'm a bit confused with the potatoes. I don't understand how they're not cooked. They're so thin in a deep fat fryer that they should cook within like a minute.
And I had a couple chips that were nice and crisp, but then the other two are a bit flimsy and not. So it's weird how it's all just a bit different all over the plate.
The fish is cooked, the vegetables aren't, and that includes those sauteed potatoes. It's not good. 15 minutes for your cheesecake.
It's done. I've just got to plate it
Fine.
Up.
Fine. Then make it beautiful. You've got 15 minutes.
Yeah, I'm gonna. Thank you.
White chocolate and raspberry cheesecake. if it's done well, then it's delicious.
Wow. Oh, my God! Went perfect.
White chocolate can be the most luxurious part of a dessert if there's enough, but not too much.
You should be really proud.
Yeah, it's all right, it's all right.
Knock them dead.
Thank you.
So, for dessert, you have got white chocolate and raspberry cheesecake with a raspberry coulis.
Lovely.
Thank you.
I'm not so sure that the cheesecake is set completely. There's not real shape to it. It's a bit of a mound.
Wow, it's sweet.
Whoa, that is chocolate.
I think there's so much of it, and it's so sweet, and you sort of put the coulis on thinking that it's going to make it a bit sharper, but there's so much sugar in it.
I love sweet puddings and desserts, but this is just a little sugary. Makes me kind of...
I really like the base, actually. I think it's really, really nice. It's really buttery. Rain it back on the sugar. Lovely.
Luxurious white chocolate against a sharper raspberry and raspberry coulis. Delicious flavours. Base is a little solid, isn't it, John?
Do you know what? I feel like buzzy, excited, nervous, want to cry, want to go and jump, scream, party, like all these emotions into one.
Stephanie's main course is sesame pan-fried salmon with an edamame, avocado, rice and seaweed stack. That salmon has got to have a bit of a punch with that sesame, otherwise it probably could be a little bit bland.
I think it's really important that seaweed is nice and crispy. It's a lot of mushy ingredients, so it does need that texture to kind of give it some zing.
Come on. There we go. That's an avocado with an afro. Nice. Whoa. Right, these mains have got to go.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
So I have made for you Japanese flavored salmon with a crispy salmon skin and open California roll sushi stack. So it's got coconut rice on the bottom, edamame and avocado mash in the middle, and then some seaweed salad on top and finished off with a spicy sauce.
It looks amazing.
Brilliant, yeah, lovely.
See you in a bit.
See you in a bit.
The rice is cooked perfectly for me. It's flavoured so well with that coconut.
The sauce is so nice because it's like that sweet Japanese mayonnaise, but with that punch of flavour. And then avocado and edamame is really lovely.
The salmon is cooked to perfection. There's bits of crispiness come, especially with the skin. She's just nailed it. I love this dish.
That salmon's beautifully cooked because it's been cooked in the water bath. It's still lovely and soft in the middle. It's fantastic.
That's a lovely flavour combination and some really lovely textures. And it looks great. OK, you all right? You've got 15 minutes.
It's very brave, especially at this stage of the competition. You say you get a fondant and you end up with a dry cake.
Chocolate, coffee, cream, I don't think you can go wrong with these flavours. I think this Olympian is going for gold.
2 minutes. You can turn them out if you want to. These work, Stephanie. Brilliant. Go, girl! Look at that!
Well done. That's good. Go on.
That's it. Well done. Well done.
For dessert, I have made you a chocolate mocha fondant with vanilla whipped cream and some raspberries.
Good luck,
Stephanie. Thank you. Smells delicious.
Thank you.
Yum.
I love the fact that it smells of chocolate and then you take a bite and you get the chocolate at first and then you get this sort of hit of mocha and coffee and it's not too strong, it's just a really lovely hint of it.
And the whipped cream is perfectly sugared. You still get the flavours of the cream as well as the vanilla and just a little bit of sweetness.
Let's be fair, two quite strong dishes for Stephanie. She's had quite a good day today. Really good. Well done, girl.
soft, melt in your mouth, fondant outside, and then in the middle, all oozy, cocoa across the top, and the warmth of coffee running through it. Great dish.
The girl's a star, John. Oh, this is good, very, very good.
I can't even analyze my feelings. That was just... I don't even have a comparison for it.
Monty, how's your biryani?
Yeah, everything's cooked.
I love a vegetable biryani. Lentils, chutney, sounds good, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Sounds nice.
Obviously, the biggest thing with a biryani is the rice. You've got to get that right.
Monty, a biryani is a rice dish with things in it. Where are your things?
They're here.
Monty, you got to start plating.
I just hope he spices it well, he doesn't muck about with the lentils too much, and that chutney sort of complements the spice of the biryani.
Good, Monty. Yes! OK! Off you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's vegetable biryani with lentils and chutney.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Enjoy. Thanks, thanks.
Woohoo! Oh, that's spicy. Ooh.
The chutney.
Oh, my goodness, it's really spicy. But the spice is kind of the one thing that's giving it some kick. The rest of it is a little bit bland.
On its own, the chutney's way too hot. Biryani's a little bit bland. But together, I think it works really well.
I like the aubergine and the potato. I like the vegetables in it, but there's no punch to it. I want something a bit bigger.
The biryani hasn't got the impact that the dal and the chutney has. If you mixed all the chutney in with that biryani, you'd have a lovely dish. But that biryani should stand up on its own.
Yay! Monty, come on, come on, come on.
OK.
Right, you've got 15 minutes, OK?
OK.
Before your dessert.
Chocolate mousse with cherries steeped in kirsch. Yum.
What's kirsch?
It's a cherry liqueur.
Is it?
Monty, we got 2 minutes, my friend.
It's got to look beautiful.
Presentation's key.
Have I got enough time to do that circle or leave it?
What do you want to do a circle on there for?
Just like little dots.
Go on, then. That'll do, that'll do. Oh, tempering chocolate, making chocolate mousse. Look at you. How's that?
Not out.
Let's go. Go on, Monty.
The dessert is chocolate mousse with cherries and kirsch.
I love the chocolate work.
Thanks, mate. Thanks.
It's not like a light mousse, is it?
Is this a mousse?
I mean, that's amazing.
Tastes nice. It's a really lovely, rich, chocolatey taste. But it's more a truffle mixture to me.
Mm-hmm.
At least you are bang on the button. That is the inside of a truffle, which is quite hard to make, to be perfectly honest, sometimes.
I would have loved to taste a bit more kirsch. I don't taste many more flavors than just chocolate. And it is nice chocolate, but it's not moussey chocolate. And it is just so thick.
Oh, the chocolate mousse is quite hard. It's like a chocolate truffle in a glass. Lovely cherry across the top with that kirsch. It is quite firm, though.
I mean, look.
Yeah, I'm pleased. I'm glad I had enough time for the garnishing and also just to do a bit of decoration on the dessert. I had a bit of taste of everything. It all tasted nice. I'm very happy.
These four celebs, I think, really stepped up to the mark. I have to say, I think that Stephanie's two courses were faultless.
Yeah.
They were really good. The fish was cooked really well. Everything was seasoned very well. The dessert was clever and delicious. I tell you what, the lady is a star. Let's put her straight through to a semi-final. Further and further Gemma gets in the competition, the more and more she enjoys it. Her fish on papillote today was a lovely idea, and I thought the fish was beautifully cooked. John, the vegetables weren't cooked. The cheesecake was a lovely flavour, but not great in appearance. And also, to be honest, our guests weren't that impressed.
Zoe cooked for us Goan, prawn and pumpkin curry. She made her own naan, which were undercooked, but a really good flavoured sauce. There was a lot of work in that main course.
The flavours of Zoe's dessert were superb. The orange she'd used wasn't at all sweet. It was a deep flavour, and that was a lovely flavour with the chocolate.
Monty's dishes, I thought the dal was beautiful. The chutney, yeah, ferocious. But actually, the main part of the dish, the biryani black flavour. The mousse wasn't a mousse. It was more like a chocolate ganache in a glass. There are issues with Monty, but I am really pleased about his progress. Stephanie is our standout cook. She is a semi-finalist. On that, we agree. Who, out of the three remaining cooks, is going to join her?
I would really love to stay in the competition now. I think I've become very fond of cooking, and I feel that I could do more.
I'm hoping that they think, yeah, Monty has got the potential to improve further. Let's keep him in the competition.
None of us are pro chefs. None of us want to be pro chefs. But I'd certainly like to become a better cook. I really would.
We really appreciate all the hard work you put into the competition. And I know you've all improved as cooks, but we've had to make a decision. The first Celebrity MasterChef semi-finalist is Stephanie.
Well done, girl.
Very, very well done. Our second semi-finalist is Zoe.
Well done, Zoe.
Thank you.
Well done. Mm-hmm. Well done.
Well done.
Thank you. Well done.
I've had a brilliant time. It will be a relief to cook without John and Greg around. Eyeballing. And that's it. Done.
From where I started to where I come from, I feel I've made a lot of progress and I don't think I could have done any better.
There's a moment of joy that's then completely eclipsed by a moment of, oh, right, here we go. I'm going to have to get myself one of those fancy flamethrowers, aren't I, for the kitchen at home. I'm going to be doing all sorts.
I'm so happy and I'm so tired. The problem is then you start getting a little bit greedy, like, oh, if I'm a semi-finalist, then I kind of want to know what it's like to be a finalist.
Cheers.
Thank you. Mmm, not bad.
Next week, it's the last of the heats. And five more celebrities take on the challenge.
Whew. I never even sunbathed, so this is too hot for me.
It's so stressful.
Face on fire.
What you've successfully pulled off, I think, is great. Makes you feel comfortable, like you're in Granny's house and she's looking after you.